Greetings, everyone, in the name of our Lord Jesus, as we gather together, either in person or online, to observe the seventh Sunday after Pentecost. Again, we welcome anyone, wherever and however and whenever you may be watching this. We're glad to have you with us today. Let us begin our worship with the confession and forgiveness. Let us rise as we are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sins. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Let's remain standing for our opening hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Continue with the glory to God.
Thank you.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, from you come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works. Give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Our first reading comes from the seventh chapter of the book of Amos. Amos is not the kind of prophet who was attached to temples or royal courts. Rather, he was simply an ordinary farmer from Judah, called by God to speak to Israel, which was the northern kingdom. God's word of judgment from Amos conflicts with the king's court prophet Amaziah, whom Amos encounters at Bethel. So Amos says, "This is what the Lord God showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, in his hand. And the Lord said to me, 'Amos, what do you see?' And I said, 'A plumb line.' Then the Lord said, 'See, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword.' Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, said to King Jeroboam of Israel, sent to him, saying, 'Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all of his words. For thus Amos had said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from the land.' Then Amaziah said to Amos, 'O seer, go and flee away to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and prophesy there. But never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary and it is a temple of the kingdom.' Then Amos answered Amaziah, 'I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, Go, prophesy to my people Israel.' The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." And now we will hear Psalm 85. "I will listen to what the Lord God is saying, for you speak peace to your faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to you. Truly your salvation is very near to those who fear you, that your glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Faithfulness shall spring up from the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness shall go before the Lord, and shall prepare for God a pathway." Our second reading comes from the first chapter of the letter to Ephesians. In Jesus, all God's plans and purposes have been made known as heaven and earth are united in Christ. So through Jesus, we've been chosen as God's children and have been promised eternal salvation. This text is the basis for the message this weekend. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he has lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time, to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ, we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we who were the first to set our hope on Christ might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now let us rise as we're able for the gospel acclamation. Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. King Herod heard of the disciples' preaching, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is a prophet like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I have beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias held a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he'd heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, well, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on the platter. The king was deeply grieved, yet out of respect for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately, the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. Now, when his disciples had heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, help us always to remember it's all about you and not us. Help us to remember, Lord, our purpose is to fulfill your will. For you created us for your pleasure, from your pleasure. You created us to fulfill your purposes. So, Lord, each and every day you would remind us to turn to you, to trust in you, to remember that our value, our self-worth does not depend upon the world, how the world views us. Help us to remember our value, our self-worth comes from you and you alone. Help us to remember every time we look at the cross, to remember your great love for us and how you have accepted us. Help us to accept, Lord, that you have accepted us. And Since we know, Lord, that we are loved and accepted, we pray that you will help us to share this with one another. Help us to show love and kindness to a world which so desperately needs it. Lord, we pray that as we meditate on your word and we reflect on it, your word alone be spoken and your word alone heard. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's not about you. The purpose of your life is far greater than your own personal fulfillment, your peace of mind, or even your happiness. It's far greater than your family, your career, or even your wildest dreams and ambitions. If you want to know why you were placed on this planet, you must begin with God. You were born by his purpose and for his purpose. This is a quote from the opening paragraph of The Purpose-Driven Life by Rick Warren. Although I read this book many years ago, and in my previous church, we studied in small groups Rick Warren's 40 Days of Purpose, these words, this message is still fresh. I got to meet Rick Warren in person a few years ago when I went to a conference out in California, and I actually had a one-minute conversation with him. I shook his hand even. I didn't wash it for a week. I'm just kidding. It was inspiring when I got together with thousands of other pastors, all different denominations, everything from Roman Catholic to Pentecostal were there. We were there to support one another and remembering that it was all about God and not us. Our purpose is to live out God's purposes. And while I did not, of course, agree with Rick Warren 100%, as he's a Southern Baptist and I'm a Lutheran, nonetheless, when I met him, when I got together with all the other pastors, it was a reminder to me of how everything starts with God. It's all about God. It's not about us. This is the message of Ephesians. In the first chapter of Ephesians, which we just heard, it starts out beautifully. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ. What an image. He destined us for adoption. God chooses us and claims us. And he does this according to the good pleasure of his will. God has chosen us, claimed us, adopted us out of his pleasure. Isn't that beautiful? God has adopted us according to his pleasure. I mean, after all, doesn't it mean something to be chosen and claimed, accepted by someone? I mean, don't we all, at least to some degree in our lives, look for signs of approval? I know I have, throughout my whole life, looked for pats on the back. The problem has come when I have sought approval from what others think in the world rather than from God, and when I forget that I'm a child of God. I do have some painful memories of when I was a kid in elementary school, and even into middle school somewhat. In gym class, I always dreaded the team selection process, where we would all line up against the wall, the teacher would pick two captains, and each captain would pick from everyone lined up against the wall who would be on their team. I was always either the last or second to last person picked because I wasn't the most athletic. Have you ever experienced that? Being the last person picked? It's kind of embarrassing when you're the last person left standing against the wall. And certainly we have all experienced rejection. Maybe we've been rejected for a job. Maybe we've been rejected by a loved one or rejected in a relationship. We all need some kind of approval, don't we? For it's very hard when we are rejected or insulted or degraded by someone else. It doesn't make us feel too good about ourselves, does it? But what Ephesians reminds us that ultimately what matters is what God thinks of us. Ultimately what matters is God's approval. We need to remember that God's the one who created us, and God created us out of his pleasure. God created us because he loved us. God didn't have to create us. God didn't have to create the whole universe, but God did it. He created the universe. He created us out of his love, out of his good pleasure. God intended for each and every one of us to be born, and God knows us inside and out. The world may reject us at times, but God doesn't. Because God created us, we are valuable. We are worth something. We just need to remember it all depends upon Him. We have been chosen to be on God's team, and we're not last on the list. And when we accept that God has accepted us, that's where we get peace. That's where we get serenity. When we accept that God in Christ has accepted us, it's all about God. God's approval of us is what really matters, and not what the world thinks. And God's approval cannot be earned. While the world often measures us by how well we measure up to worldly standards, how rich we are, how powerful we are, whatever status we've obtained, we need to be reminded that ultimately God is the one who determines our worth, our value. I'd like to share a story with you. I shared it last fall in one of the recordings, but unfortunately we had sound issues at that time, so the punchline got completely cut out because of overdrive. So bear with me if you remember this story, but I thought I would tell it again because it's one of the classics. You know how we all at times seek approval? Well, there was a young preacher starting out his very first call out in a rural area. And of course, this preacher was a little nervous, especially that very first Sunday. He was looking, hopefully, to get some positive feedback, to know that, you know, he was in the right place, that and that God was with him. So he gets up, he leads worship, he preaches his very first sermon, and on the way out, as most people walked by him and shook his hand, they said, "You know, good job, Pastor. I enjoyed your sermon," and so on. But one elderly woman shook his hand and said, "Pastor, that was a very warm sermon." And he said, "Well, thank you very much." Well, the next few weeks, the exact same thing happened. On the way out of church, most people shook his hand and said, "You know, good job. I enjoyed your sermon," whatever. And this older woman said, "That was a very warm sermon." She said that exact same thing every week. So now he was beginning to wonder a little bit. And so he decided he would ask her. And sure enough, that next Sunday, the same exact thing happened. And so after she once said that was a warm sermon, he asked her, "Pardon me, but what exactly do you mean by that, that it was a warm sermon?" And her response was, "Not so hot." Ouch. Sometimes we hear things like that. Sometimes it's kind of, whoa. We don't have to worry about that with God, though. I like to tell that story. And one of my members of my previous church will, after that point, whenever she liked my sermon, she'll say, "That's a hot one." But again, our approval, our self-worth doesn't come from what others say about us. It comes from God. And yes, in our lives, we do have to work with people and so on. We all need some approval, once in a while at least. We all need love. But yet, we need to remember again that God has accepted us. What God thinks of us is what matters. After all, if you think about it, you know, what are the two greatest commandments again? Love God and love your neighbor as yourself, right? But think about that second part. We sometimes don't really think about it. Love your neighbor as yourself. We need to learn how to love ourselves. When we love ourselves, then we're able to love others. It makes sense, doesn't it? I mean, this is not talking about being self-centered or selfish. It's simply we're not able to really love others if we don't love ourselves. That is, if we don't accept God's love for us. When we know that we are loved and we accept that we are loved by God, it comes naturally to love other people. We have been adopted by Christ, claimed and chosen out of love. When we accept this, we are able to share it with others. After all, we know that if we don't feel good about ourselves, it's hard to be good to other people. And another Rick Warren quote that I've always appreciated is, "Hurting people hurt people." Isn't that true? When you see people out there that are angry and nasty, impolite, rude, or whatever, I'll bet you these people are hurting. They don't feel good about themselves. They're not at peace with themselves, so they're not able to be at peace with others. But we need to remember that God does love us already. God has accepted us for who we are. Yes, God wants us to learn and grow and be obedient to him. God wants us to follow him. But there's nothing we can do to make him love us less or more. We belong to him. God loves us first. If we want to really be reminded of how much God loves us, all we got to do is look at the cross. In the cross, we are reminded how far God was willing to go to show us how much he loves us. We didn't do anything to deserve Jesus' death on the cross for us. He laid down his life willingly. He did it freely out of his own pleasure so that we may know that we're loved and accepted and can share this with others. So again, we love God and love our neighbors as ourselves. Accept that we've been accepted. Accept that we've been chosen. In Christ, none of us are worthless. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Now let us rise as we're able and join in our next hymn, The River. We now continue with the prayers of intercession. We continue to lift up all those who have been on our prayer list. And again, I'd like to remind everyone, if you have any joys or concerns you'd like us to lift up in worship, please let either Amy or myself know. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks that you have adopted us and chosen us to be your own. Lord, we pray that as we have been loved and accepted by you, help us, O Lord, to show this love and acceptance to others. And help us to remember, Lord, that often those who are difficult are hurting. So, Lord, we pray that you will help us to be peacemakers. Help us, Lord, to show love and acceptance even to those for whom it is difficult. But help us to remember each and every day, Lord, especially that we are loved, we are valued. And Lord, we lift up before you all those in need of healing in mind, body, or spirit. We especially lift up Tori and her baby, Bonnie, Amy, Tina, Mardell, Cindy, Kathy, Helen, Jackie, Dawn, Gerald, Ginger, Anna, Sam, and all others we name. Gracious Lord, we continue to lift up all those impacted by COVID-19. We especially pray for all medical workers, all those distributing vaccines. Lord, we thank you for the gift of the vaccine, and we pray that those who are hesitant will take it. Lord, help us to remember that we're all in this together. Help us to continue to work together to protect one another. And Lord, we pray for guidance as we, as a church, along with all other churches, as we are all moving forward into the fall. Help us, O Lord, to be mindful as we go back to more in-person worship, more of a sense of normalcy. Help us to remember, Lord, that the pandemic is not over yet, so we still need to be careful. We still need to be mindful. But show us, Lord, how we can worship together and also be mindful of one another. And Lord, we also lift up before you all those who are serving our country in the military. We continue to lift up Ryan, Shane, Zachary, and all others we name. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now let us pray together using the words that our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction. May the blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon you now and forever. Amen. Before the dismissal, again, I'd like to thank everyone for joining us in worship. And a reminder that through the rest of the month of July, we will be continuing to offer online worship as well as Saturday mornings at 9 and Sunday morning drive-up at 9. We have a couple of events coming up. On Sunday the 18th after worship, in the conjunction with our Bible school, we have some activities planned after worship on Sunday the 18th. This is open to all families, not just for kids. We'll have little activities available where people can be creative, use building blocks and stuff. This is a way to celebrate VBS, even though we're doing it differently this year. So that's on Sunday the 18th after our outdoor worship. Anybody, all ages, are welcome to join us for some fun fellowship. And on July 25th, we're going to try something a little fun. We're going to celebrate Christmas in July. We're going to be reminded of the joy of Christmas. The spirit of giving is for all of the year, so we're going to have a little fun on the 25th as well on the Sunday. And Bible studies continue this Thursday at 10, the study of Romans, and Sunday mornings at 8, the study of the Lord's Prayer. It's not too late if anybody wants to join in with us. So now, let us go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.